Good evening. We're going to do things a little different. I've got some helpers tonight because I done preached my voice away. And so they're going to help me lead us in singing tonight. So go ahead and stand up with us. We're going to sing Standing on His Promises. Didn't they do a good job? Amen. Brother Nick.
Amen. Well, welcome back to our service this evening. I'm glad you're here as we have a chance to look at some of the things that happened in Brazil this past week. Looking forward to that. But before we get any further in our service, we're going to have a word of prayer. I'm going to ask Brother Leon if you would open us up in a word of prayer this evening. Can be seated. I'll give you a few announcements before the choir comes and sings for us. In case you missed it, it was fun watching the girls hurl water balloons this morning at the boys. A lot of them got wet, as they should have. They lost, so it was fun. So I think some adults got that on video. If you want to, was Miss Kimmy? Were you recording that? Did you record that? If you want to see it, go ask Miss Kimmy. She got a video for it. $5. Yep, $5. As a reminder, August 21st, we're collecting school supplies for two elementary teachers in Kinston. That's due by the 21st. Again, if you'd like to make a donation to that, you can see Miss Kimmy. August 24th, this Saturday, we have two activities going on, junior activity and a teen activity. As I said this morning, they're going to be at the same time, 2:30 to 6:30, meeting here at the church. And both activities, they're going to get wet, so we've asked that they bring a change of clothes with them, knee-length shorts or swim trunks, and a dark T-shirt, and they can come in, and then they'll change out of that after they're done with the activities. So keep that in mind. September 1st is moving up Sunday, when our young people are going to move up to the next class for Sunday and Wednesday night youth classes, so keep that in mind. A little further out, September 15th through the 18th, we have our fall revival with Brian Newton. Looking forward to that. I love Brother Brian. He's one of my spiritual heroes, and so I'm glad to have him with us and hear from him that week. And then September 28th, a little farther out, we have the junior activity to Moo Moo Farm. Is that right, Isaiah? Moo Moo. Where'd you find that place? Moo Moo Farm. It sounds like they're going to have fun there, though, so... The cost is $7. They're going to meet at the church at 11:30. They'll have see some animals, train ride, bouncy house, ice cream is going to be fun, so don't miss it. And the last thing I want to mention, Miss Jamie asked me to let the church know that once we find out when Miss Shirley is having her surgery in September, we're going to be making some meals for her after her surgery. Again, that date will be announced, but do keep that in mind. That's all I have by way of announcements at this time. Hope you enjoy as our choir sings for you.
We see, we knock, it'll be open, we'll find. He will answer our prayer. That's our God's promise to us. You boys are going to have to come on up here. They're new at this. They need some encouragement. Amen. We're going to have you stand up with us. We're going to join together and sing, I'll Fly Away.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life has grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars have flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Amen. Thank you so much for that singing. At this time, Brother Nick's going to come and give us some instructions.
All right, I'll ask the usher to make their way forward. During the offering, we're going to be playing a video for you that Hannah put together for us before she left, or after she left, before she started school. And we'll play that for you, give you a little snippet of what our week in Brazil was like. After that, Miss Nawanis and Sophie are going to come sing a song in Portuguese for you. And then I'm going to come up here and give you some pictures and things, and we'll kind of go through the week as it went. But before all that, we are going to take up our offering. So I'm going to ask Brother Emmett, if you would, to pray over the offering for us. Amen. You can be seated. Don't
Wanted to share just a little bit before we sing, but Nick told me I have 5 minutes. And so I'm going to try to be very brief. But the song that we will be singing is called Jesus, Thank You. And in Portuguese, thank you is obrigado. I guess there's a song that Hannah already knew it from the States, the English version, but I'd never heard it before in English or Portuguese or Spanish, or I'd never heard that song. So my first encounter with this song was at the teen rally. So we got there to their house on a Friday evening, because we flew out Thursday, but got there Friday evening, and then that very next day was a teen rally. So we had something come up really quickly after we got there, and it was like our first ministry encounter since getting there, and it was just the sweetest time with these teenagers. It was teenagers from 3 or 4 different churches, I can't remember, and that song, they sang it that first night, and that's the only time that I heard that song, that Saturday evening, and it's been stuck in my head. And it's so funny because I only knew that one word, obrigado. So I kept humming everything else and singing that song. So then I took it upon myself, I will learn the words to this song. And I don't want to learn it in English because it wasn't introduced to me in that way. And so Spanish and Portuguese is a little bit similar, but Portuguese is harder, I think, because they take Spanish. Sophie, the way she said it when I got home and started trying to teach her the little chorus, she said, it's kind of like Spanish, but not. It's kind of like they took Spanish and pronounced it the wrong way. And that's exactly what Portuguese is, except it's right to them, and they probably think that we're doing it wrong. But it's just, it's like a twist that makes it just a little bit harder. We just had a very sweet time, and I went online and listened to Hannah and Tillman's testimony, what they shared. So I don't want to say the same things that they said. They kind of told you a little bit about the different ministries they have going on. But today, in just this little snippet, I just wanted to come at you from a different perspective. There's three couples serving right there, and the parents are in the main church, the Acocks, which you've probably heard that name. The dad has been there, the Acock dad that's serving there now, has been there since he was a child. I think maybe he was even born there. He was born there and raised there. He met his wife here at the States at Bible College. When they were grown and had four kids, they went back to serve. The wife had to learn Portuguese. And then they had four children. Those four children, that's who I know the best, because the two older daughters went to college the same time my sister and I, our age. So we did the math, and about the time that we came to the States from Cuba, my sister and I, their family left the States to go to Brazil, and that was 1997. And so the girls were raised in Brazil, and those girls came to the States for college at Southeastern, and that's how we met them and established a friendship with them. They married two young men that were studying, you know, to serve in missions. They served in the States the first few years of their marriage, and then each couple ended up going back to Brazil and serving there. They've had their children there. The one couple has four little girls, and then the other couple that Nick and I are even closer to, they have three children, and those are the Webbs, the Blackwells, and the Acocks that have been there the longest. So there's three couples, but they're all a family, and it's just neat to go back. And we had a sweet time of reminiscing, you know, college days when we were younger, before children, before ministry. But to fast forward now and see that the things that it almost feels like we were kids back then in college training, and to see them still serving, that was encouraging for me to see. But then later they told us at the end of the week, our time there, they were telling Tillman, Hannah, Nick, and I, that even more so than the resources that we took for the school, more so than the ministries, at the teen rally and the different preaching and the different things they had going on while we were there that we helped with, it says the thing that has encouraged us the most is just you guys coming and loving on our families, you know. And we've been supporting them financially ever since they went to Brazil, because we know them so well. But I was reminded that it's not just financial. It's not just a financial commitment that we are to have with them. Like, they're in the trenches right now, and it can be kind of lonely, you know. In their homes, they speak English, but every time they step out of their home, they're entering this other world that they are now a part of. But it's like two worlds are clashing, you know. And so there is joy in serving. There's a lot of work, like Tillman and Hannah told you guys, and the laborers are few. But they need our prayers even more so than our financial support. And that is something that the Lord just convicted me while I was there, just loving on them. I was reminded of, these are your friends, but they're also servants, and they're serving, and there's joy in what they're doing, but there's also hardships in what they do. And the best help that I can, the best encouragement that I can be to them is not once every however many years I'm able to physically be there and love on them, but to pray for them. And anyway, I think Nick will share a little more later. But Jesus, Thank You is what the song is called.
Cruzo seu mistério, não posso entender. No Calvário agonizou. O Deus Santo e Justo a Filho esmagou. E o fez por mim do amargo fel beber. Jesus, Teu sangue me lavou, obrigado. De Deus a ira toda aplacou, obrigado. Inimigo foi sacrificio que me aproximó. Agora teu amigo sou. Gloriosa graça derramaste a mim. Nesse bondade, o Deus que não tem fim. Jesus, teu sangue me lavou. Obrigado, de Deus a ira toda aplacou. Obrigado, inimigo foi. Agora estou à mesa. Obrigado. Obrigado, Jesus. De minha amor, quero viver pra ti. De minha amor, quero viver pra ti. Teu sangue me lavou. Obrigado, de Deus a ira toda aplacou. Obrigado, inimigo foi. Agora estou à mesa. Obrigado. Obrigado, Jesus. Inimigo foi, agora estou à mesa. Obrigado.
Thank you, girls, for singing that. I appreciate it. It was great. You go ahead and put that first slide up there, brother, and I'll start clicking through here. I do want to express my thanks again to the church for how quickly you jumped to our aid to help raise the funds to send us here. It was a phenomenal week. I'm excited to be able to tell you about it, but it just means so much to me. All those of you who jumped in at a moment's notice to raise the funds for us, it means the world to us that we have a church that would back us like that. And I just want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. and I just want to also give thanks to God because if you'd asked me a few months ago, I didn't think this trip would happen. But the Lord has worked a miracle in the life of my wife and our family this year, and we're just so thankful for that. It's you know her story, you know what she went through earlier this year, and what God did to get us there is a miracle in and of itself. I'm sorry. You can see behind us there is the city of Barbacena, which is where our missionaries live, the three families. Here is in a city called Chiradenches.
And you'll see behind us there are some mountains, and then to the other side is a very large Catholic temple. It was very eye-opening for me this past week to see the influence that Roman Catholicism has over the people there. Very different from here in the States. You know, in the U.S., we have a Judeo-Christian heritage. And so Catholicism here in America, at least as I understand it, it very much tries to disguise itself and blend itself in with Christianity. But that is not so in Brazil and in many other South American countries. In that country, Catholicism has a hold over the people. A large majority of the people of Barbacena and the rest of the country of Brazil identify as Catholic. And for those who live there, that means that they're also given over to idolatry and all kinds of other evil. I wanted to show you in this particular temple, as you go inside, you'll see the confessional there where you can go and confess your sins to the priest. One thing that makes this particular temple unique, it has the second largest amount of gold of any church in the world. It's an astonishing thing to see. When you go to the front of the church there, you'll see the entire front of it is overlaid with gold. I've got a quick video here. You can see from left to right just how massive the front of their sanctuary is. And every detail, every ornament, every piece of molding is overlaid with gold. And the Catholic Church is a rich church. And they built such churches by selling things like indulgences to the people. And so in Brazil, there's a week in the year before Lent called Carnaval. And during Carnaval, they're giving over. They just live how they want to for a whole week. They give over to every whim of their flesh, all of their lustly appetites. And they can purchase indulgences before the week of Carnaval. And it allows them, in their mind, they can sin as much as they want because they've pre-purchased the Lord's forgiveness. And many of the Catholic churches were built in that manner. Very sad. Another Catholic temple we visited while we were there, this particular church is an exact replica of the Catholic Church in the Vatican, just on a smaller scale. One of the things I wanted to note to you, I learned while I was there, there are hundreds of different saints that the Catholics pray to. This particular saint, you can see there, it's inside their church. And if you look at the base of that statue, you'll see little pieces of paper. Those are prayer requests they have written and laid at the feet of this particular saint. And if you look at the first picture, there is a slot in the base of that statue where you can put in some money. And of course, what they're trying to do is buy the favor of this particular saint in hopes that he will answer their prayer request. Here you'll find in Barbacena is a large graveyard cemetery. They're a little different there. They don't bury people below ground, if you're Catholic anyways. They have these structures, boxes they put their family in, and when another family member dies, they'll gather up the bones, push it into a corner of the coffin, and put the next family member in there. It's different. But I show you this because you'll see there, there's a building in the middle of this cemetery. And here they can go and offer incense and pray to the saints in hopes that they can pray their family out of purgatory. Family that has already passed on and who have been laid to rest in that cemetery. Very sad. It was surprising to me just to see how strong of a hold Catholicism has over the people there. It's not like it is here, like I mentioned, but one of the things that was very apparent to me is Catholics there, they very much see the difference between us and Protestant Christianity. I heard several stories by the missionaries there of things they were not able to do. For instance, they weren't permitted to rent a particular home or buy a particular piece of land because it was found out that they were Christian, and so they wouldn't let them. The first church that we were able to minister at on Sunday was J.D. and Brianna Webb's church. It's in a nearby city, about 30 minutes from Barbacena, called Carandayi. And in their church, there is a lady in her church. Her name escapes her name escapes my memory. Do you remember her name? Anyways, she got saved under J.D. and Brianna's ministry, and she went home excited to tell her husband that Jesus had saved her. And he told her that he didn't want anything to do with her and that he was going to leave. And the next day he packed up his stuff and left home. I'm happy to tell you that he came back. And eventually he gave his life to Christ too. And they're both now still serving at that church in Carandayi. But amazing story. I wanted to share that story with you. One of the first things we did, we came in, like Nawadi said, on a Friday evening, and the very next day, on a Saturday, we held a youth rally where several churches got together, a kind of unique thing for them. They don't get to do that a lot, and so we had different youth from several different churches come together at the church in Barbacena. We had a time of fellowship. We played some games. You can see here that Rodney, he taught them how to play cornhole, and so me and Tillman, being the good sports that we are, beat them soundly in cornhole, and we had a little tournament, and me and Tillman were victorious, and so we didn't give them any mercy, poor things, but they had fun nevertheless. And then that night, after we had supper and played some games and had some fun, we met upstairs in their fellowship area, and you can see all the youth were there from several different churches. We sang several songs, which is awesome to hear them sing in Portuguese. And then I got to speak for my first time with a translator, which was very different. I was warned by Pastor Coita before I left that would be very different, and it was. But me and Hot Rod, we found a rhythm, and I would say a phrase, and he would repeat it, and then we just kind of had to find our rhythm along the way. But the Lord blessed in that service. You can see there's me speaking, and after the service, you can see there at the a few youth came to the front and prayed for some different things. There was even several young men who stayed after a while and just prayed together. It was a blessing to see the Lord working in their life in those different ways. And then that Sunday morning, again, this is the church at Carandayi. That Carandayi is a much poorer city than Barbacena, but it was so good to be in service with them. This is JD and his people there in Carandayi, a small church, but they've really grown that ministry. Hot Rod, again, helped me translate. I preached in Sunday school. One thing different there, they have Sunday school in the morning, and then their main worship service, they have Sunday evening. And so whereas we have, you know, multiple services morning and evening, they just have the one in the morning, one in the evening. But I preach Sunday school at Carandayi that morning, and then I preach Sunday evening at Barbacena. But I wanted to show you a clip here. If you could turn the volume back on back there, Brother Ashley. It was... But their praise was absolutely deafening. There were only a few gathered together that day, but I'm telling you, it just blessed my heart to hear them worship the Lord the way that they did. And believe me, there were several who couldn't sing, but they were singing anyways and singing loud. And man, it was just an awesome thing. There, they don't have AC, and so all the windows are open. And so I can just imagine people walking by hearing them praise the Lord as loudly as they do. It was a wonderful thing to hear. You can see us and the Hannah and Tillman there. We took a picture. That's the front of their church at Carandayi. And then that night, we were in service at Barbacena. You can see that's the front of their church. And then right next to it, it's hard to make out the lettering, but right next to their church is their school, which I'll tell you about in just a minute. But we had a few neat opportunities that night in service with them. It was a sweet, sweet service. Lord met with us, really just blessed us. We sang a couple of songs, Hannah, Tillman, Nawadis, and I. For them, they put the Portuguese words on the screen so they could at least know what we were saying. But They don't get a lot of special singing there, and so that was a treat for them to hear someone different come and sing. Nawadis shared her testimony that night, just sharing what the Lord did in her life that allowed us to even be there in Brazil, which blessed the heart of several people. And then, of course, Brother David Acock, who is the pastor at Barbacena, the one she mentioned, he is he translated for me in that main service. And you can see there a picture of their auditorium. They've got a good crowd of people there in that church. The Lord's really blessed them. They've grown, and the Lord's doing a great work there. There's a picture of us with the Acocks. That's David and Annette Acock. They've been there now for many years, but we're so glad to be able to be in service with them. And then here's a first picture I want to show you of the school. So because they're below the equator, the seasons are opposite us. So when we went to visit, they were actually in winter. So the weather was beautiful. It would be hot if we were in summer, but we went at the right time of the year. But because it was winter, they were just coming off of their winter break. And so that Monday was their first day back in school. And so they were gracious enough to let us go in the school and sneak a picture of them while they were in class. Here you can see beautiful little place they have for the kids to come and play. You can see, I love the architecture. A lot of the buildings have lots of big open windows, and so it lets lots of natural light in. As you look out, just the scenery is just beautiful. And so what a blessing it is that they are able to have this school. It's an oddity. It really is. You can probably count on one hand the number of Christian schools that preach sound doctrine there are in the entire country of Brazil. They have a really unique opportunity in the city of Barbacena. Again, we're talking about a large city of upwards of 150,000 people, most of which are given over to Catholicism. But at least in their Catholicism, public schools are trending much like here. They're being given over to this woke ideology and this liberal ideology. And so people who are devout Catholics, they also don't like that. And so because the alternative is worse, there's many Catholics in their community who have decided to send their kids to this Christian school. And unbeknownst to them, some of their own children are being converted to the Christian faith. And eventually, they've also had the opportunity to convert some of the parents as well. And so the school has been a tremendous asset to their church. They're only able to have third or fourth grade at the moment. They had just a small number of kids when they started a couple of years ago, but they're now enrolled with over 40 kids, this with a mixture of kids from their church as well as kids from the community. And their goal is to continue to expand until they finished out their elementary grades. And if the Lord gives them opportunity, they would love to add middle and high school later. But I'll give you a few pictures. This is a picture of their lunchroom. Miss Annette, she's cute. She had every room was a different theme, and so that was kind of her thing. She loves having a theme in every different room. This is the art room they're able to have fun in. Here's one of their boards as they're getting ready. Learning is an adventure. Here's another room. It has a jungle theme. So they have fun with it. Nawadis was able to, one of the projects they worked on while they were there is they set up this display with the balloons. They were getting ready to have a Father's Day celebration at the school that took place after we left, but they helped set up this display so that the kids in the school could take a picture with their dad after the celebration was over. Because it was their first day back from winter break, Chidu came out. Chidu is the turtle, and he welcomed the kids as they were coming in from winter break, and they had fun watching Chidu dance and act a fool in the street, welcoming the kids in. But I got a couple of videos of Chidu if you want to see that later. I even got one of him doing a cartwheel, which is pretty funny. But that was Rodney Blackwell. He dressed up in that turtle costume and welcomed the kids as they came in. Of course, you can see there was Brother David and two of his granddaughters. They are there with the school supplies that we were able to send to Brazil. That's going to be a great blessing to them. I think it costs about as much to get it there, ship it there, as it did to buy the supplies themselves. It's expensive to be able to do that. So thank you to those who helped with that. Several people had already purchased supplies. With the money that you gave, I used some of the excess to buy the rest of the things that were on that list. And so we had to buy a couple of extra suitcases and to ship internationally. But with one of those suitcases, we were able to deliver all these school supplies, which would be a great blessing to them throughout the year. And then with one of the other suitcases, we just wanted to bless the missionaries and their families. And so we gave them just a bunch of treats they could only find in America. And you can see a picture of me there giving the kids some of the things that night, and they were tickled pink to be able to see some different candy and stuff. And one of the things that we really loved that week was just getting to be able to love on their families. You know, the three missionaries there, they're all they've got there in Barbacena, and they don't get a lot of interaction from people outside of that. And so it was good to love on their kids. We played some games with them and just had a good time with them and were encouragement to their families and the Lord in that way. And then the last opportunity I had to preach in Brazil was on a Wednesday night. I was away from my teens that Wednesday, but I was preaching to some teens in Brazil. And man, it was a great service. Roddy translated for me again. And after the service, there were several teens that spoke up and gave a word of testimony. And two of the young ladies who spoke, you can see them there, Rafaela and Maria, they just spoke about some of the adversity that they were going through, and they thanked me for the message, what an encouragement it was, and asked that we'd pray that they'd continue to serve in the Lord where he's planted them. But two sweet, sweet girls, the Lord is doing a great work in their life. And then we're really excited about this young man. His name is João, which is Portuguese for John. And John is one of the first young men in Rodney's ministry who's answered the call to preach. And John preached for the first time a few times this year. But while I was there, after I was done preaching, he just spoke up and gave a word of testimony, telling the class, the teens, that he felt like God was calling him to ministry. And he aspired to be what me and Rodney were doing, working with teenagers one day. And but I was such a blessing to hear John's testimony. He's such an encouragement to Rodney. They haven't had many young men like that who've answered the call to ministry. So I'm going to ask you to pray for John, that the Lord would just put a hedge of protection about him, that he would keep his eyes focused on the Lord, and that he would answer that call that he feels like the Lord has placed on his life. One of my favorite things we did that week, one of the things I was most excited about seeing when I got there, Rodney and Autumn, one of the things that they've taken on is it's been their dream and part of their vision to start a Christian camp in Brazil. And it took them many years of praying, but the Lord finally gave them a large parcel of land, over 50 acres. And they got a great price on it. They had been pricing properties for several years, and this one was twice as big and cost half as much as the other ones did, and so they knew that the Lord was in it. And they've been working feverishly. Rodney travels back and forth between Barbacena and this is about 30 minutes away. I forget the name of the town that it's in. But they've begun work on this camp, and He took us to the top of the little hill, the mountain that property is located on. You can see the view. It's just amazing. He showed us several places. They've already begun to start leveling land so that they can prepare. I think this was going to be a soccer field. This is going to be the future site of a chapel. I believe this was going to be some dormitories for the boys. And then they've already started putting up some temporary shelters. It's going to be a multi-year project for them to finish this camp, but they didn't want to wait that long to be able to start using it, and so they've already started putting up some shelters. This will eventually serve as a temporary chapel and a place where they can also eat together under these shelters. So they're already putting up some temporary shelters so they can have camp maybe as soon as next year, if not the year after that, so they can at least get the ball rolling and start ministering to some young people out on their property. until they can finish building the rest of the camp. But I was just thrilled to see that. They got a lot of work ahead of them, but I know they would just covet your prayers as they continue to work on that. It'll be a very unique opportunity for them to minister to young people and also families. They're hoping they can use these properties to be like a safe haven from families to escape the wickedness of Carnival during that week. And I want to tell you about this. I'm almost done with the slideshow, but Brother David, one of the things that he gave us a tour of his facilities, and the last room he brought us in was his office, and this is in his office. And you can see there a bell that hangs on the wall. And every time they have a convert, they are able to lead someone to the Lord. They go into that office and they ring the bell. And while we were there, Brother David was having a Bible. He had been having Bible studies with this man, and while we were there, he gave his heart to Christ. And so he took a picture with Brother David. He got to ring the bell, and I just found out today, JD and Brianna's little girl Emma. Today she gave her heart to Christ, and so she was able to ring the bell at her grandparents' home. They were just so thrilled that she made that decision, and we are thrilled for them. Again, I just want to express sincere thanks to the church for all that you gave. You went over and above and beyond to help us get there. And I just want to share a short challenge with us tonight. If you turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 9, Luke chapter 9. We're going to be looking at verses 35 through 38. Nawadi's mentioned this verse in her testimony. Hannah and Tillman, I think, mentioned this verse when they spoke last week. They didn't know that I was going to be speaking on this particular passage, but I feel like this is just where I was led. Again, I'm not going to be long-winded tonight. I know I've taken up a good chunk of your time already, but I did just want to share something with you. As before we read the passage we're going to be looking at, several notable events have already transpired in this passage before we even get to our text. In the beginning of this chapter, we see the well-known account of the man who was sick of the palsy. Parallel passages tell us he also had four friends who led him down through a roof to get to Jesus. After that, we see Jesus, he calls Matthew to be a disciple. Matthew, who was a tax collector, an unlikely candidate to be a disciple, he's called to be one of the 12. Tax collectors were not very well thought of in their day. They often stole from the people, and because of that, they were hated. Yet Jesus sees something in Matthew that others don't and calls him. In the very same chapter, we see Jesus heal the woman with an issue of blood as she touches the hem of his garment. And that he does while he's on the way to go and raise Jairus' daughter from the dead. From there, we see Jesus healed two blind men, then a deaf man possessed with a devil. Miracle after miracle, all in the same passage. It's a rich, rich passage. I say all that because most of the people who Jesus interacts with in this passage are people that in their day would have been overlooked, disliked, maybe even looked down upon. But Jesus doesn't cast the same scorn on them that others do. He sees something in them that others don't see, and it evokes a certain emotion in him that moves him to act. We see that very same emotion present in the Savior in the passage we're about to read. So if you have your Bibles there, Matthew chapter 9, we're going to read verses 35 through 38. Scripture reads, "And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion on them, because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Then saith he unto the disciples, The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. As you would expect, because Jesus has performed all these miracles, fame of him begins to spread throughout the region. Here we have this man. He teaches like no one else teaches. He's performing signs and wonders that validates that what he's saying is true. It confirms that he is who he says he is. He is God's son in the flesh. Now, I'm not a famous person, and I hope to never be. But I can imagine how exhausting it would be to constantly try to be escaping the crowds and the paparazzi. You got the glitz and the glamour that comes with fame, but also comes all the other stuff. It can be hard to get a moment of privacy, I would imagine. And Jesus is becoming a very famous person. And you might expect that the crowds are now clinging very closely to him, following him around. And maybe you think, well, that would annoy Jesus. But the Bible says that Jesus feels a very different kind of emotion when he sees the multitudes of people who are following him around day after day. And the Bible says he felt compassion. And it's not just a surface level kind of pity that he has on them. The word used here in the Greek, it speaks to a kind of compassion that strikes you to your core. It's a gut level kind of empathy. So why did Jesus have such strong feelings of compassion toward these people? Matthew tells us Jesus had compassion on them. He saw them as sheep, having no shepherd. Now we know that sheep aren't very bright animals. We talked a little bit about that in junior church this morning with the kids. Sheep rely on the care and guidance of a shepherd to lead them. They need guidance and leadership for even the most simple of tasks, finding good sources of food and water. They need direction. I want us to see firstly the people in this passage. Scripture says that Jesus saw that they fainted and were scattered abroad. These people, they're harassed and helpless, distressed, dejected. You can literally translate that as they were torn and thrown down. The question is, by who? Who are they torn and thrown down by? And the sad irony of the passage is they were torn and thrown down by people who they trusted to be leaders and shepherds, but were instead false shepherds. We find the people of Jesus stay exhausted, trying to follow the leadership of the Pharisees and Sadducees, who burdened them with traditions and laws that were not found in the Word of God. Exhausted in trying to earn the approval of these false teachers, they are spiritually starved for a real shepherd to lead them to a place of spiritual nourishment. And the Bible says that Jesus has compassion. Compassion on these poor sheep, because they are left wandering. Wandering about, hoping to find someone who can point them, lead them to the living water. There's also a problem we see in this passage. Jesus looks out at the faces of all these poor people. Every face represents a different family with different needs and different problems, each one needing the love and care of a spiritual leader to guide them to the true shepherd. They weren't getting that. Such a massive need to reach these hungry people, people who are eager to hear the truth and receive the word. The problem that Jesus presents to them in the passage is there are such few leaders to reach them and teach them. Jesus looks out and sees a bountiful harvest, incredible opportunity, souls ripe for the taking, but not enough laborers to win them with. So many people, so few laborers. And this problem leads Jesus to make a petition of the disciples. Jesus asks them to pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would send out laborers into his harvest. You know, we look at the world around us, millions, billions of people all over the world. who were being led like simple sheep into the wiles of the devil. It was astounding to see a country dominated by Roman Catholicism, a religion that bears the name of Jesus, but has hijacked his name and plunged the people into further darkness. You know, and the closer we get to the return of Jesus, the greater it seems our world plunges itself into darkness. I know it can be discouraging to look at the state of our nation, our churches, our world, our leaders, and think, man, this is hopeless. And it can feel that way at times. But would you agree with me that the need for the light of Jesus to reach the nations is just as great now as it's ever been? Would you agree with me? The need is great, amen? And yet, for whatever reason, it seems fewer and fewer people are answering the call to go into the harvest. Fewer and fewer people serving in ministry, answering the call into ministry, onto the mission field. When I look back on my graduating class at Southeastern, there's not too many of us that are still serving in churches and ministry. It's discouraging when I think about it, you know. Perhaps some of them, they decided they were never called to ministry. Perhaps some became discouraged from their call. But only a few remain. There's such a need across our nation, across our globe, for more laborers. When I was in Brazil, I saw a need that was so great, a wonderful opportunity, a harvest ripe for taking, but an incredible burden is being shared by just three missionary families. I told you the city of Barbacena has a population of nearly 150,000 people, majority of which are being led to their death by a false religion that has stolen the name of Christ. They call themselves Christian, but their gospel is a false one, attaching works to salvation and burdening people with traditions and rituals that are nowhere found in the scriptures. I saw three missionary families who are carrying the torch, bearing the load. Three families who are stretched incredibly thin at times, trying to minister in different ways to different ministries, often giving of themselves physically, spiritually, to the point of exhaustion to accomplish the work they feel God has led them to. And don't get me wrong, those three families, they're bright lights in the darkness of Brazil and Barbacena, but they're three lights among a city of 150,000. I left Brazil burdened for their ministry, burdened for the work that lies ahead of them. And the truth is, they need more laborers. They need more help. And I'm praying specifically, I'm going to ask you tonight, I'm praying specifically that God would raise up laborers for the mission there in Barbacena. I'm praying that God would call more missionaries and workers to work in this foreign field. I'm praying that God would maybe even use some of their own efforts to raise up some people from within their own churches who would answer the call to ministry and further the gospel in Brazil. Do you believe that God is still calling people into his harvest? Do you believe that? I believe he's calling now more than he ever has. But there are more refusing the call than are answering the call. And as the harvest continues to grow, I see the laborers continue to dwindle. And for that, I believe God calls us to action. Jesus doesn't just tell the disciples to pray in this passage, and you'll find in the next chapter if you read it, he then commissions the 12. You know, sometimes when you start praying for the harvest, you're praying for God to send somebody else when you're the answer to your own prayer. We all play a part in reaching the nations. There are some people in this church who go above and beyond to give. You give financially, you give sacrificially to the cause of Christ, to advance His word to the nations. But I wonder tonight if there might be some, if there might be a younger person who God would call to this specific field. Maybe he has, maybe he hasn't. I would encourage you to pray, Lord, could it be me? Whether you give or whether you go, we all are commanded to pray for the harvest. I'm going to ask you to bow your head and close your eyes this evening. Jesus gives us a very specific petition in this passage. And as much as he says it to the disciples, I believe he says it to us. Pray ye therefore, the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. I want to ask you a very specific question tonight. I wonder, by show of hand, if there's anyone in this room who'd be willing to commit with me to pray for these three families and their work. If you'd be willing to commit to pray for them regularly, that God would send laborers to their harvest, would you, by show of hand, before myself, before the Lord, I see all those hands. I appreciate you. I appreciate you. And I hope that you will stay true to that and you will keep your commitment to pray for these precious families and pray for the work that God has put before them. But specifically, I'm asking you to pray that God would send some help their way, some laborers. My heart was blessed, richly blessed this week to spend time alongside of these three precious families. But it was also a burden for them because the need is great and the work is greater.